Hello and welcome to episode 51 of the Bearded Banter Podcast, the gaming podcast where Bones is finally back.
Hi. I haven't been on like
You haven't been on ever. Since July.
Okay, man, I've been working.
You've been busy and then you were gone for like a month.
True.
Doing your own things.
Yes.
But today this is episode 51. You wanna know the last episode?
Big 5-1.
Yeah, you wanna know the last episode you were on, Bones?
It had to be like 42.
43.
Oh, I was so close.
The last episode you were on was episode 43, so I mean it's been a while.
Close, man.
It's been a while
since
I can't talk about video games.
Fucking remember the words to the actual song.
Really?
Yeah, I have no idea what he says.
It's ingrained in my memory for some reason.
The only part of that song I know is it's been a while. Yeah. Yeah, see, exactly.
So anyway, welcome to the show. We're going to do things a little differently today. We're just going to have a general discussion episode today.
Yes.
And we're also doing this special video episode for a couple reasons.
To welcome the Bones back.
Yeah, one, this is the first episode Bones has been on in like over 2 months.
Yes.
Two, there's not much in terms of news going on this week, so I thought we'd skip the news altogether. And three, we got fucking games to talk about. Bones and I went game shopping over the weekend, and we spent a pretty penny.
Yes.
I'm not going to disclose how much was spent.
It was like $500.
Yeah, between the two of us, it was like $500. But yeah, we got some games, and there's not much news, and Bones is back, so we're just gonna have a general discussion episode.
Yay!
And you can look at our stupid faces while we talk about video games like losers. So anyway, we both got games. I split this up in the games that I bought and the games that you bought, because we're both terrible people.
We are.
And
I went out thinking I wasn't gonna spend more than $100, and I spent like $270.
He spent like two something. I actually spent less than you did.
You did. I spent like $270.
I spent like $252 or something like that. I don't know. But yeah, we spent a lot of money and we got some games.
Yay.
That we've played, and we're going to talk about them on the show.
Well, so, I mean, there's one I haven't played.
Yeah, there's one out of all of these games,
and we've
either
got
one or both
10
of us
games.
Have played.
We got 10 games.
No, we got 9 games.
10.
We got 9. I got 5, you got 4. That's 9.
2.
Well, 2. We'll get to that.
I got 10 games.
So yeah, I guess
not personally, but overall.
So yeah, I guess one of us is going to start talking about one game, and then we're just going to switch off. And go through both piles. So, Bones, you want to start?
No, you want to start.
Speaking of two games, you've got two games over there, I guess.
Okay, so, first off, we've got Fire Emblem Fates Conquest.
So, tell us about this, Bones.
I've never played a Fire Emblem game before. Just pointing that out.
Well,
I did play the demo of Awakening on the 3DS.
Yeah, that came out a couple years ago.
Yeah, which came out a couple years ago, but I just played the demo like probably 6 months ago, maybe.
Not even.
And I'm not really one for the whole like turn-based strategy RPG type thing.
Yeah, not.
But I actually really enjoyed it, and I've heard that overall, Fire Emblem is one of the best series.
Yeah,
out
it's
there.
One of it's one of the better strategy series out there.
So I decided that because fucking Conquest looked pretty cool. And, you know, it's got a pretty neat story kind of thing going on. I would pick that up. And, apparently...
Damn EB and their deals.
Well, it's not just EB. I think they were doing it, like, everywhere for this game.
I don't know about that.
I don't
know.
But apparently, if you bought a physical copy of one of the games, you could get the digital copy of the second game, which in this case would have been Birthright, for half price.
Yeah, and that was $50 here. It's $50
yeah,
Canadian.
Yeah, it was $49.99 for Conquest, and then it was $24.99 that I spent to get Birthright to complete, I guess, the game, other than Revelations.
Yeah. Other than Revelations, yeah.
Revelations that, is an additional $25, but it's
You're probably going to buy it eventually anyway.
I might buy it eventually. It's just instead of like choosing one side or the other, you don't choose any sides.
Yeah.
But yeah, I thought that was a pretty good deal.
Yeah, so basically,
so out of this, I got 2 games.
Yeah, so basically, spending normal game price, you got 2 games.
Yeah, which is nice, and yeah. I'll play both of them all the way through.
And
I'm
it's
already
like,
really liking Conquest. I like the direction that Conquest is going in, and I'm interested to see what direction Birthright goes in.
Yeah, and Fire Emblem, it's like it's a long game too. It's a fairly long. You know, it's nothing to gawk at. It's pretty lengthy because it's like an RPG strategy kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm already 10 hours in and I'm only on chapter 11, I think.
You played it for like 2 days straight.
Yeah, I know. It's really good. I guess I went with the more difficult of the two because Conquest is actually more difficult. You get less XP. There's more actual, like, strategy type gameplay that goes on in Conquest versus, like, Birthright is more of the easier, more laid back kind of thing.
Yeah, Conquest is technically the evil path, right?
It's not necessarily the evil path. Like, you really have to get into the story to understand, like, what's going on. Mm-hmm. But it is the more difficult of the two games. I did read online that Birthright, like, if you're just starting out with a Fire Emblem game and you want to get into Birthright is the one that you should pick. It's more beginner friendly.
It's like Baby's First Fire Emblem.
Yeah, exactly. But so far, I haven't had too much of a problem with Conquest. I think I've lost one battle so far, and that was because I was stupid and moved my person off the green space, and somebody took my green space. So
damn you, that was my green
exactly. space. So yeah, I'm really enjoying it so far. I'm interested to see. Or to play Birthright after I'm done with Conquest.
Yeah, so how far are you into that then?
I don't know.
Because you said 10 hours, but how much is that in terms of, like, the overall game?
Well, I think I'm on chapter 11 now.
And you have no idea how many chapters
there are? I have no idea how many chapters there are, but there's a lot of story in between each chapter.
Yeah, there's a lot of dialogue, right?
Yeah, and then once you hit chapter 7, you actually, like, get your own fortress that you can, like, upgrade. You can interact with the people at your fortress.
Oh, you mean the My Castle thing?
Yeah, the My Castle thing. You can build your relationships with your party members. Mm-hmm. You can form, like, intimate relationships with people because I believe you can get married and stuff like that.
Oh, God, romance.
But, yeah. You can, like, build relationships between you and your people and also between your different units and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You can get them to talk to each other and form relationships.
Just what you need. Another game with romance options. Yeah, exactly.
But you can, like, level up your castle. Well, not level up your castle, but you can build different things that give your castle, like, a boost if you have, like, a castle invasion mission that you mm-hmm. can play. You can buy, like, stores to build in your castle so that you can get new weapons and upgrades and stuff like that. It's mm-hmm. pretty cool. I really like it. So
what's the gameplay like?
I'm enjoying it. It's literally like turn-based strategy. You actually just like
isn't it like grid-based?
Exactly. Like you move, you have like when you select a character, you have a grid and then you can move a certain number of spaces like forward or to the side or whatever.
In a single turn, right?
In a single turn. And then you get to move everybody in that turn.
Okay.
So you get to move each of your characters a certain amount of spaces. You can battle enemies. There's also on certain maps that you play on, there's like environmental things that you can use, like okay. ballistas, fire orbs, that kind of stuff that you okay. can also use to damage enemies from afar. You can't kill them, but you can like take their health down so that somebody else can go over there and kill them.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a pretty standard like
strategy game.
Overhead strategy game kind of. Yeah.
Yeah, I was surprised that you were actually into that because
it's actually really fun. I really
like it. In terms of strategy, I know you're a lot like me where like strategy isn't exactly your cup of tea.
Yeah. And that's why I played the
demo for Awakening.
The Awakening demo first because I kind of wanted to get a feel for it because I wanted Conquest for a while. I think I told you about that.
Yeah.
Like for a while I wanted Conquest because it looked really cool, but I never actually played Fire Emblem. So
yeah, because
I did download the Awakening demo and I was like, oh, this isn't that bad actually. It's pretty neat. It's pretty it's user friendly. Like there's not a lot of stuff that's like real confusing to figure out.
Mm-hmm.
When you move somebody, you can either like you can drop them in a space and then you get like a menu beside them that you can use like items, you can attack, you can do this, and this.
Yeah, that's the one thing about strategy games I've noticed is that they're either overly simple or overly complicated.
Yeah, I think this is a good balance of like complicated and simple because there's a lot of stuff you can do, but it's kind of like simplified in that like you get like a menu or whatever that you can do stuff if you're on an empty space.
Like it's
or
very...
if you attack an enemy, like you literally just like you hover your person over that enemy and then you get on the bottom screen, you get like a... like a potential outcome type thing. It mm-hmm. tells you how much HP you could potentially lose versus like how much damage you'll do to the enemy.
Oh, so it's like risk versus reward.
And it lets you, like there's different compatibilities. Like there's three different types of weapons. There's red, mm-hmm. green, and blue weapons. And each one of them is weak to another type of weapon. So you can like weigh whether you should fight that enemy or try for something else, or whether like you should not move that person and move somebody else that would damage that enemy more.
Okay.
Stuff like that. And then you can switch between weapons as well.
So it's like beginner friendly, but it also has depth to it.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's not just a, you know, move around and, you know, you automatically kill whoever.
Move around and waggle your stick at people.
Yeah, but it's also not so complicated in that you're trying to, like, allocate points to certain things and stuff like that. It automatically does it for you.
Oh, okay.
And depending on, like, how well you did getting all the XP that got you to the next level, you'll get more or less reward for that.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's kind of cool. I like it. I'm really enjoying it so far. Obviously, I've been playing it.
Pretty frequently
the last couple days since I got it, so
you played it like all day Sunday.
It's so
for the most part.
It's so good. I like it. I'm kind of surprised that I like it, but I really do like it.
Yeah, it's cool.
10 out of 10 would recommend.
10 out of 10 would recommend.
Well, I mean, if you like strategy games. I didn't even like strategy games and I like this game, so 10 out of 10
Do you think that could be a launching point for you to get into other strategy games?
It depends. Like, I really like the feel of this
game. Or will it be, like, if it's, like, Fire Emblem, maybe. Otherwise, eh.
That's what I think it's going to be, because I really like this particular game, but I don't think I would be able to get into, like, some of, like, the deeper strategy
like StarCraft.
Games. Yeah, I don't think I would do very well in that.
I don't think I'd do well at StarCraft.
I think I would like Fire Emblem-type games, but I don't know if I would get into, like, StarCraft and stuff like that.
Okay.
Yeah. So 10 out of 10 would recommend.
All right. Well, then I guess I'll go into my first game. Here I've got Dark Souls 3.
Oh, God.
Oh, boy. Oh, so much to talk about. Well, first off, I got the Day 1 edition, which is it's the same price as the normal edition. So you're not spending a pretty penny to get your hands on this. the Day 1 edition includes this lovely... It even says on the back of the box, it includes this lovely slipcover.
Does it really say
that? That's a bullet point
for the Day 1
edition. It has a Day 1 edition oversleeve.
Oh, fuck.
So, yeah.
Wow, that's funny.
So, yeah, the Day 1 edition, it comes with the sleeve, if you want the sleeve. It comes with a digital copy of the original Dark Souls.
Yes.
Only on the Xbox One version because of backwards compatibility. So... Yeah, you get a digital copy of the original game. You get this, like, mini Prima starter guide.
Yeah.
It's like a little mini strategy guide just to get you started on the game. Tells you how
it
works and all the mechanics and stuff.
Actually, like, at the end, it gives you a code for, like, a free digital exclusive at Prima Games.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not actually sure what that
is, but...
If it's, like, more strategy...
Yeah, and also...
it gives you actually story and stuff like that,
Yeah, it does.
Too.
Like,
apparently there's a story.
Apparently there's a story in
dying.
Dark Souls. And it also comes with a CD soundtrack. Soundtrack CD.
Yeah, that's pretty nice.
Yeah, which is cool. Like I didn't even notice until I actually, like, went to pop the game in that there were two discs.
I know. He was like, well, what's the point in buying the Day 1 edition? There's not really anything I want. And then he's like, ooh, soundtrack.
And then, oh, soundtrack. So, yeah. But the game itself, fuck this game. Fuck.
It's fucking Dark Souls. What did
it's
you expect
fucking,
me
Yeah, to? I knew exactly what I was getting into.
It was
but
Dark
I was like
Souls.
I was like, you know, maybe it'll be kind to me since I've been away for a while.
It looks really nice.
It looks
like graphically it looks really nice.
Yeah, it looks a lot more there's a lot more detail in the graphics.
I mean, it's very similar style. Like they're all very
It's the same art style.
Much the same style, but it looks very nice.
But you know, seeing as how this is the first Dark Souls game made from the ground up for the current gen consoles, it's going to look a lot better. It's a lot more detail. There's a lot more visual fidelity to it. The performance is a little there's a lot of frame stuttering that I noticed.
It dips
in frame rate a lot.
It's basically like really hard Skyrim, and Skyrim is
which is weird to think because the Dark Souls 2 was a higher frame rate than this one, which is weird. But anyway, the game itself, it's Dark Souls.
It's Dark Souls.
If you fucking hate yourself and
If you want to die repeatedly,
if you're a nihilistic piece of shit,
for stupid reasons,
get this game.
Just die.
But yeah, it's pretty standard Dark Souls stuff. There's not a whole lot different from it. The only thing I've noticed, and I might be wrong on this, but the only thing I've noticed is that there's a couple new classes. Like specifically the Pyromancer, which is the one I got, is like a mage. So you can like there's magic in this game now. Which I'm not sure if there was any magic in the previous games.
I thought it was just like swordy slash slash.
But like, you know, you have your heads up display. You got the red bar, which is your health, and then the green bar is your stamina. Now there's a blue bar, which is your
mana.
And there's a couple magic specific classes.
That's pretty cool.
I picked the Pyromancer, which is like a fire mage.
That's literally what I do in Skyrim.
Yeah.
I have fire in one hand, sword in the other.
Yep, pretty much.
This is my sword, apparently.
Yeah. Sword.
This is my fire. This is my sword.
So yeah, there's a couple things different. Obviously, the new classes. There's obviously brand new areas, new bosses, new ways to die.
That fucking boss that you encountered at the end last night, I was like, holy fucking
Where's
shit.
Where's the fucking fire? Where's the fucking bonfire? God damn it.
Oh yeah, there's a fucking note. I don't know where exactly you were. It's bonfire ahead, and we were like, where's the fucking bonfire? And then you got destroyed.
And I went through three more areas and there was no bonfire, and
after
I'm like, people are assholes.
Like three times.
People are assholes and they lie.
Yep. So Dark Souls.
But yeah, you know, it's not much different from any other Dark Souls, so if you like Dark Souls, pick it up. It does a couple things different, but overall, it's the same game I love to hate.
I think everybody loves to hate Dark Souls.
So, yeah, there's that. All right, what's your next game?
We've got Luigi's Mansion. Luigi's Mansion.
Dark Moon.
Oh, yeah.
For the 3DS.
Dark Moon. It was a Nintendo Select title, so I got it for
It was only
$30.
Are
Nintendo Select titles $20 in the States?
I don't know.
They probably are. Fuck you, US.
Because Canadian inflation.
Anyway, so Luigi's Mansion, Dark Moon.
You started playing this last night.
I did. I started playing it last night. I'm about three missions in. Because it's like mission-based, right? Mm-hmm. So like, there's what the fuck did he even call it? The Haunted Mansion or something like that? Creepy Mansion?
Yeah, whatever.
Ghoul Mansion. Some mansion.
The Google Mansion.
Ghoul Mansion or Manor or something like that. Anyway.
Yeah,
So, like, basically, like, you got, like, you have, like, a little, like, lab or, like, hub world. Not really a hub world, but, like, this little thing that you go back to in between missions. Mm-hmm. Like, you get sent back and forth.
It's EGAD's
like,
lab,
the
right?
The manor and his lab, yeah.
Yeah. Professor EGAD.
So, like... First of all, you start out with nothing.
Nothing.
You have a flashlight.
You're Luigi.
Which is cool.
And you're a scared pussycat.
Luigi is very scared. basically, like, if you stand around long enough, he just, like, basically
he's
shits
just
his
like,
pants.
He's just like,
yeah.
Mario!
And then, like, a fucking mouse pops out of nowhere.
And he's like, wah!
And it's like, okay, Luigi, you need to calm down.
Yeah, you need to calm your shit, bro.
So then you get the, Poltergust.
The Poltergust.
5000. It's the upgraded version.
It's a goddamn vacuum cleaner.
So now you can vacuum clean a lot of things except for ghosts, because then you have to find the little light that goes on the front that allows you to suck ghosts or whatever.
The fuck?
No, maybe it's not.
Oh, just to throw this out there, neither of us have played the original.
Yeah, I've never played fucking Luigi's Mansion, and I always wanted to.
Yeah, I always wanted to.
I decided that the next best thing, other than spending $80 on Luigi's Mansion...
Was to get the sequel. Yeah, because...
And so far, so fucking good.
Yeah, because Luigi's Mansion, the original, A, it's rare nowadays,
and B,
because it's a GameCube launch title, and B, when you do find it, it's fucking expensive.
Yeah, it's fucking expensive as shit. We should have got it when we got the GameCube.
Yeah, we should have, but we didn't.
Because we're idiots.
Well, we got the GameCube like 6 months before we got a Wii,
true.
So hey.
So yeah.
We didn't grow up with it.
So far, so good. I'm really enjoying it. The mechanics are really easy to master. It's basically like R to suck, H... R to suck ghosts into your vacuum cleaner.
Yeah, but you know what I'm saying.
A to flash your light really bright to stun them, which is why you can't...
They're weak to light?
Yes, which is why you can't catch ghosts as soon as you get the Poltergust, because you actually
need the light.
To flash the light, and it goes like really, really bright, and it stuns them, and then you can suck the ghosts.
Okay.
So far, that's what I've done.
Okay.
Collecting keys, coins... there's money in this game, apparently.
Yeah, there's points.
Money is your XP points. Oh. That you upgrade every 2,000 coins you get.
Oh.
Yeah.
I didn't know Luigi's Mansion had RPG elements.
Apparently. So you can get coins, you can get $5 bills, you can get gold bricks.
$5 bills.
I'm serious, man. You can collect dollar bills.
You can collect singles in Mario games.
No, seriously. Okay, so like coins are 1, bills are 5, and then gold bricks are like 15.
Huh.
Yeah. So anyway, your gold is your upgrade, which is kind of nice because you actually get upgrades. I just thought it was going to be like hunting ghosts. So the whole premise of Dark Moon is to collect the pieces of the Dark Moon because the King Boo destroys the Dark Moon at the beginning with, like, evil energy. So now you have to collect the pieces of the moon to put the moon back because the moon is what's keeping the ghosts from being mean to you. That's the plot. I'm serious.
It's like fucking Piccolo shoots the moon out of the sky. No, moon!
I'm serious. The Dark Moon is what keeps the ghosts, like, pacified so they're not mean because, like, at the beginning of the game, all the ghosts are, like, helping Igad in his lab and stuff like that. Well, and then the King Boo charges up the moon with, like, this dark energy and it explodes like fucking Piccolo.
Okay.
And then the ghosts go fucking nuts.
Okay, well, if the Dark Moon is what keeps the ghosts at bay, then why, how can the King Boo destroy
the
Dark
Boo
Moon?
Yeah, but Boo is different than a ghost.
It's bullshit.
Boos are different than ghosts in this world because the ghosts are like green and red and blue and whatever, different colors and shit like that, and then the boos are different.
Well, shit.
Yeah, I know. I know, right? So, like, the Dark Moon keeps the regular ghosts from being mean to you.
But it doesn't affect boos.
But not the boos. The boos are dicks.
Yeah, boos are dicks. Big bulbous dicks.
Except if you're playing fucking Paper Mario and then they're not.
And then you have the boo lady help you.
Yeah, she's
And she
nice.
Slaps people.
She's nice. So, yeah, I haven't played that much of it, but fucking so far, so fucking good.
Cool.
If you haven't played Luigi's Mansion before, I think keep saying Luigi. I can't stop saying Luigi. If you haven't played Luigi's Mansion, like, for the GameCube, if you never got around to it, like,
This is an easier alternative.
Yeah, buy this. I'm pretty sure the mechanics are all the same.
It's
pretty much the same game. As far as I can tell, you run around with a fucking vacuum cleaner strapped to your back and you suck ghosts.
Yeah.
Not off, but you know, whatever.
You gotta get the ectoplasm out of them.
Yeah, I mean, like, this is a great alternative if you never played Luigi's Mansion.
Like us.
Like us.
Yeah.
And
Luigi, like, this is just in normal stores.
Yeah, it is. There were like five copies
at Best Buy.
It was awesome. Also, Luigi is, like, way better than Mario. I'm sorry, Mario.
Yeah, Mario's a piece of shit.
You actually suck.
Don't you remember that one cutscene in, like, that one Mario sports game where he scrapes his foot on Luigi's shoe and, like, spits in his face?
Yes. But anyway, Luigi is better than Mario.
Yeah,
so
Mario's a dick.
Get Luigi's Mansion.
Yeah.
Dark Moon.
Yes.
10 out of 10 would recommend.
You're always given the 10
I
out
know.
Of 10. So anyway, next game I got here is Doom, the 2016 reboot of Doom. And in this nice alternate cover. Like, yes. It's very rare nowadays that, like, games have alternate covers. You can just slip the cover over and it's like, oh, this is cool. Look at it.
Yeah,
very nice.
It's way better than the first one.
Yeah, because it's just the Doom guy just standing there with a gun. It's like, Doom.
Yeah, he's just like, Doom.
But here, he's like fighting the hordes of hell.
Yeah.
It's cool. Very anyway, cool. Doom. This game's fucking awesome. Right around E3 time, they announced that they were releasing a demo for Doom, and I played it because Doom was on my wish list for the year.
Yes, I made him download it because he was like, oh, that's a thing. I'm like, fucking download it now. And we did.
Did you stick a knife to my throat? Ow, God.
Sorry. I did.
So anyway, so Doom. Yeah, I played the demo when that came out, and I loved it. It was fast, it was fluid, it was gory, it was over the top. You just run around and shoot demons in the face.
It's pretty cool.
And then you rip...
I thought they were aliens. I don't know which one I'm thinking of, but there's aliens in one of these type of games.
Nah, Doom is strictly demons.
No, I know Doom is strictly demons, but there's a type of game that is similar to Doom that's fucking aliens, and I don't know which one it is.
Yeah, I have no idea what you're talking about. So yeah, I played the demo, loved it, and just recently picked it up a couple days ago. It was on sale, and yeah, it did not disappoint.
Did not.
I'm three.
I haven't played it yet.
I'm three missions into the campaign, and it's super fun. Basically, it's what I experienced in the demo, but even more, because...
We're not in a demo.
Yeah, we're not in a demo. It's a full game. But yeah, it's basically a throwback to the original Dooms.
Yeah.
Like Doom 1 and 2, where it was just a really fast-paced, run-and-gun kind of gameplay. I know Doom 3 went in a different direction with the whole, like, survival horror thing.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people liked Doom 3.
Doom has always been survival horror.
In a way, yeah.
Because the fucking demons are scary as shit.
They're scary as shit.
And you have to shoot them to survive.
Yeah. But I like the way you went with that. It makes sense. But yeah, this was basically a huge throwback to the original Dooms.
It plays, looks really
it
amazing.
It plays
too.
Almost identical to the originals.
It also looks amazeballs.
Yeah.
When you boot it up, it like looks fucking awesome.
Yeah, it looks fucking awesome.
The demons are more demon-y than ever.
Yeah. They come straight out of the demon hole
the
and are like...
The Doom guy is more shooty gun than ever.
You weren't around for like the beginning of the game, where it's like, there's a scientist there and he's like, oh, hello, I'm Dr. What's-His-Face. I opened a portal to hell to do research to further the benefits of mankind. Now we need you. And then he punches the screen. He's like, fuck this shit.
That's awesome.
He literally punches the screen and he's like, fuck it, I'm gonna go shoot demons. I don't give a shit.
Yeah, exactly. More shooty gun than ever.
So yeah, the story, the portal to hell, close it, fight demons.
Yeah, I mean, like, it doesn't really have, like an in-depth plot.
Doom doesn't need, like, an intricate, overarching narrative. It's a game where you run around and you shoot demons in the face. That's all it needs to be.
Yep, exactly.
And I'm glad that this game is exactly that and nothing more.
Look at this fucking cover.
I know, it's really nice.
It's so nice. And also, yeah. The back.
But yeah, the campaign is nice. Great. It's really well-paced. Because the whole...
Look at all of those demons.
Yeah, because the whole game never really slows down. Like, as soon as you fucking start it, it's just super fast, never slows down for anything. There's a lot of secrets, which I like. Not a lot of games do that anymore, where it encourages you to explore and find a bunch of secrets in the levels, especially with a game as linear as Doom is. It's like,
that's kind of cool.
Yeah, it's really intricate with the secrets. Like, you have to really have to look around and try and find them.
You have
them.
To try your hardest.
And the game told me that there are secrets in the levels that unlock original levels from the original Doom games.
Like, remastered?
I don't know.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
But I know, I saw videos online where there are also, like, hidden areas that are... Like, remember in Wolfenstein, where there were those areas played in the original... Wolfenstein, yeah, like, they do that with this.
Oh,
there are like secret
cool.
rooms that are in the style of the original Doom, and you can get like collectibles and all that crap.
That's pretty cool.
And the single player isn't the only thing there is. There's also multiplayer, which there a lot of people were worried about this game when it was coming out because a lot of people said the multiplayer beta was eh.
Yeah.
So naturally, nowadays people thought the whole game was going to be meh.
But. However.
Bethesda proved you wrong, because this game's fucking awesome.
Yeah, bitch!
I haven't played the multiplayer yet, but, I'm probably going to soon, and I'll see if it's any good, because I know it's like an arena-style kind of thing, so we'll see about that. And this also has Snap Map, which is like a map creator.
Is that Snapchat?
Shut up.
For maps?
No, but it's like a map creator, where, you can create multiplayer maps, you can create campaign levels...
Oh,
like,
that's cool.
Like, the shit I've seen people do in Snap Map is fucking amazing. I've heard that people have redone the entirety of the original Doom games in this game's map creator.
Cool.
So, yeah. Doom overall, it's a complete package and one of the best games of the year, in my opinion.
10 out of 10
10 out of 10
we'll
recommend. Metal as hell.
Metal as hell.
So anyway, moving on.
10 out of
your
10,
next game.
So metal. So we've got here is some Zero Time Dilemma.
Tell us about this.
Which is the third game in the Zero Escape series.
It says it right on the front.
Which starts with 999.
999.
If you haven't played 9 hours, 9 persons, 9 doors. Is that how it goes? Mm-hmm. Hours, persons, doors?
Yeah.
Whatever. If you haven't played that game, fucking play it. Because, okay, Axis... And Spike Chunsoft, that's what it is, fucking put their heart and soul into these games. This one in particular, they didn't actually have the funding to do it after Virtue's Last Reward. And as a fan, you didn't know whether they were going to do a third game. And I believe that they actually got crowdfunding for it.
Yeah, you told me that they did like a crowdfunding campaign.
Yeah, I believe that they did crowdfunding for it. I'm not too sure. Well, so don't fucking quote me on that. But like, literally,
this game was crowdfunded, Bones 2016.
Yeah, don't fucking quote me on that, man.
Yeah, if it's a struggling game developer who didn't have the funds to make the game in the first place, it makes sense that they would crowdfund it.
999 didn't sell as well as they'd hoped. It was kind of like a cult classic kind of thing.
It has a very indie vibe to it.
Yeah, and then Virtue's Last Reward was really good, but also only like marketed toward like the niche people.
It was only marketed towards the fans.
Yeah, exactly. Who like 999. Which were few and far between enough to begin with.
Like, I didn't even know it was a sequel until you told me.
Yeah, because 991 was so good, I was like, fuck yeah, I'm going to buy the sequel.
Now you have all three.
So now I have the third one, which may or may not have been crowdfunded. Don't quote me.
Don't quote me.
But yes, struggling developer who made a really fucking good game and has made a really fucking fantastic trilogy now. Literally, fucking go pick up 999 if you haven't played it. It's like a combination of escape the room, puzzle solving. There's a pretty in-depth story that actually goes beyond like the whole like nine people trapped in a thing trying to get out before they're killed.
Yeah, it almost seems like an interactive novel in a way.
It is. It's marketed as a visual novel, which turns a lot of people off because there's not a whole huge amount of gameplay in it.
Yeah.
Other than the escape the room stuff.
Other than the occasional puzzle solving.
Yeah. But there's a lot of choices that you can make. and it's really, really story driven. Even Virtue's Last Reward and this one, I'm finding this one is very, very story driven.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 3 hours in and I just got to the first room.
Oh, shit.
So basically everything up to that point has been story and just making choices.
And world building and all that.
So there's a really in-depth story and you have to play 999 and Virtue's Last Reward.
To get what's going on.
To be able to get what's going on in this game. If you just jump into this game, you won't have any idea what's going on.
Yeah, we'll get there.
So you can't just jump into Zero Time Dilemma without any background knowledge. And the story is really, really expansive. It spans decades.
Oh.
All the events in the actual games take place in the span of a couple years. But there's time travel. There's alternate timelines. So things that are happening 50 years in the future are
affecting the past. Another timeline.
Yeah, or affecting what choices you make in the past.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, and like things that have happened before the events of the game also impact this.
Okay.
So it spans actually, I'm gonna say it spans probably like 80 or 90 years, in terms of like background and future implications for the events of these games. But honestly, they're really, really good. If you liked, I picked up 999 because it was recommended to me because I was a fan of Ace Attorney.
Mm-hmm. Very similar in a way.
Very similar. They're both, more visual novel-y. There's,
a lot of dialogue, a lot of character building.
There's some exploring different rooms. There's like investigation. 999 and its sequels are more like puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
You have to collect a bunch of items and figure out how they fit. You're usually in teams of about, the first one varies, you can be in like teams of 3 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
So you get help and input from different people and they can like help you figure out how to solve some of the puzzles. But it's not too complicated. Some of the puzzles are really easy, some of the puzzles are really fucking hard.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, probably one of my favorite game series. I am glad that they made the third one. I'm excited to finish the game and see how they close out the trilogy.
Well, you already finished it once.
Well, I mean, there's different endings. So the first one, there's 6 endings. One of them is completely canonical and like...
So there's one true ending and 5 other endings.
There's one true ending. They all actually happen, and you can... it's not really apparent in the first game, but in the second game, all of the endings, there's, I believe, 23 of them in the
20
second.
20 or something.
There's 20-something in the second game. And it's not apparent in the first game, but in the second game, all of the endings have actually happened to you, and you can, your character, because you only play as one person in the second one, it's Sigma. And Sigma actually remembers everything that's happened to him. By the time you get to the true ending, he remembers that he died in this timeline. He remembers that this person died in this timeline. He remembers what happened in all the other 20 or something timelines before you actually get to the true ending, which is kind of cool. And I, so far, this Zero Time Dilemma is leaning the same way.
Mm-hmm.
You actually get to play as three different characters. You're on three different teams. You get to play as like the leader of each team.
Mm-hmm.
But so far, you can actually remember what's happened in a previous timeline. Like, I've already played four timelines. I haven't finished any of them, but I've started them because, mm-hmm. like, you can play, like, different snippets of each one before you actually finish it. But, like, they actually remember what happened before. And they can use that to shape, like, your decision that you make in the next one, which is really cool. I really liked it. They really did a good job with the whole, like, alternate timeline mess, because sometimes that can be a real mess.
And yep.
Like the whole like time traveling thing, that can be really fucking weird.
Time travel is just begging to be fucked up.
But they've actually done a really good job with this whole thing. I think it wraps together really nicely. Like, there's no like loose ends where you're like, what the fuck?
Why just happened?
Why would you do that? So honestly, buy fucking 999. I mean, I know it's not going to be everyone's cup of tea, but if you like puzzle games, if you like murder mysteries, if you like visual novel, like story-driven type games, fucking do it. And then buy the second one and third one.
We should mention 999 is for the original DS.
Yes.
And
yes,
then the subsequent sequels are for 3DS.
Yes. But fucking...
Did the mic even pick that up?
No. Buy them. Seriously, they're really good. They're one of my favorite series.
And
for the 3DS and probably all time. Like, really good.
Which is weird
because
you only
games.
Started playing those last year.
I know, but they're really good. They're really, I love a good story, and it's a good story. It might be confusing sometimes, but everything tends to, you know, come together at the end.
Mm-hmm.
You might be like, what the fucking, but it's a good what the fucking. 10 out of 10, would recommend.
All right. Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. My next game, here we have Just Cause 3. Now, I've been looking for this game for a while. When we got our Xbox One and this game was announced, I knew it was one of the games that I definitely wanted to get. Just because it looked like a game that was straight up my alley. It's like...
Yes. It looks
like... It's like over-the-top, chaotic, open-world mayhem. And you can go around and just blow shit up and... fly through the mountains and crash into said mountains.
It's like third-person Far Cry on steroids.
Yeah, kind of. Like, the whole atmosphere and environment definitely feels very Far Cry inspired. But it's like one of those games.
It's one of those games.
I did have all... Well, before I got this, I did have the original two. I got rid of the first one because it's very dated at this point.
Yeah.
And ironically, that was the only one I played. Oh. I have two, but I haven't gotten around to playing it yet, which is weird because everyone has told me that two is, like, fucking amazing and that I should play it. But this is the first one I played, so I have absolutely no idea what the fuck's going on. But I played this for about 2 hours or so, and so far I'm having a lot of fun with it. It's basically exactly what I expected it to be. Crazy, chaotic, over-the-top, open-world game where you just go around and you blow shit up and, you know, Viva Revolution! And all that jazz. You can also purchase the Day One Edition for your chance to win an island.
Wait, what?
Look on the front. Win an island.
I can win an island?
I guess.
Oh, shit. I want to win an island.
I don't know how. But you can win an island. But yeah, the Day One Edition, it comes with a digital copy of Just Cause 2 as well. Because backwards compatible and all that crap.
That's kind
of
cool.
Yeah. But apparently it's also the winner of 12 different awards.
Oh.
I do not know which awards those are.
He looks like, what's his face?
That's very specific bones.
What is his name?
It's very specific
Dylan
bones.
Dylan McDermott. That's who he looks like.
Who?
Dylan McDermott.
I have no idea who that is.
He looks just like him. I'll Google him.
Okay. Well, I talk about the game.
We'll show his picture because...
Okay. Well, So yeah, Just Cause 3. I'm having a lot of fun with it. The game looks beautiful. The graphics are very nice. But again, there's some frame rate stuttering that I've noticed. But it's not too much to...
Okay. Look at his face and then look at this guy.
Okay, yeah.
He looks like Dylan McDermott.
I see the resemblance.
I know, right? He was in American Horror Story.
Yeah, I saw the caption. But anyway. So yeah, the graphics are very nice. The voice acting is good. It's very cheesy though.
Yeah.
I do like all the characters, everyone I've met so far, even though I have no idea who the fuck any of them are. Other than Rico, who's the guy you play as. The world itself is huge and there's tons of stuff to do in it, and there's a lot of freedom of choice with how you want to go about things. Like how you want to traverse the world, or how you want to do missions, or
that's pretty cool.
You know, you can boat across to another island to get there, or you can just climb to the top of a mountain and wingsuit over there. It's your choice. You might crash into a couple mountains on the way, but
yeah,
I haven't gotten
you were wingsuiting through the valley, crashing into pretty much everything.
I haven't gotten the hang of the wingsuit yet. Okay,
apparently
there's a DLC that came out for this that makes your wingsuit a rocket pack.
Oh god!
So you get like a jet pack that you can use to fly around.
Oh god!
Which I definitely want that DLC at some point. But so yeah, this game gives you a lot of freedom of choice of what you want to do. There's a lot of collectibles. There's a lot of vehicles to unlock. Different weapons you can get. The world itself is huge and it's very detailed, and there's a lot of stuff, like there's a lot of intricacies in the world that you wouldn't notice if you were just crashing into the side of a mountain in your wingsuit.
Like you frequently are.
Yeah, like I am. The gameplay is weird because it's a third-person shooter, but it doesn't have any aiming. Oh. It's all hip aim. As far as I can tell, there's no like aiming down sights or whatever.
Oh.
So it's all hip fire, which I got the hang of it after like the first half hour.
Yeah.
But I just found that kind of weird, especially in a shooter nowadays that doesn't have an aiming option. Unless I'm missing something, I could be missing something.
Yeah, but like it's kind of like a third person kind of like platformery type thing.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of traversal.
So like I don't know how they would have fit in the aiming thing. Because most of, like, third person is, like, if you're doing a shooter worth aiming, it's going to be over-the-shoulder camera.
Yeah.
This isn't over-the-shoulder camera. It's kind of, like, behind you or, mm-hmm. like, above you at some points. So I'm not sure how they would have done the whole aiming thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I see what you're saying. But, there is a lot of traversal in this game. It's very platformer-inspired from what I've seen. Like,
climbing mountains.
Yeah, you climb mountains. You have a grappling hook.
You have a hook shot.
You basically have a hook shot.
You have a fucking hook shot.
You have a hook shot, which you can use to, like, grapple up ledges and mountains, but you can also use it to, like, tether people together, and you can tether a car to a fucking gas tanker and blow it up. You can tether a guy to a fucking exploding drum, and he'll blow up.
Basically, everything you've done in this game is just blowing shit up.
Well, yeah, that's what the whole game is. The whole story behind the game is we're trying to, like, bring down this tyrant.
By blowing up everything.
By blowing everything up. We will bring Viva la Revolution by blowing everything he's brought up to the ground. Burn everything.
Okay, then.
Like, literally, every story mission I've done so far is go to this place and blow up everything there is.
They realize that after the tyrant's gone, they're going to have to rebuild?
That's what they say in the game. Because Rico's like, I will blow everything of his up. And then Mario, his like friend or something, he's like, and whatever you'll destroy, we will rebuild.
I'm just like, wow, okay.
And I'm like, oh, okay. So it's one of these kinds of games. But yeah, that's actually one of the criticisms I have of this game. I'm only a couple hours in, so I have yet to see if things will change, but there's not a lot of mission variety so far.
Oh, it's basically
like
go
like I said,
something up le- and leave.
Yeah, like I said, every mission I've done so far is liberating an outpost, and the way you liberate it is blowing it up. You liberate it by blowing everything up.
Oh my god.
Like the
why?
That's one of my criticisms is when you're liberating an outpost, there's these things called chaos objects, where there's a certain amount of objects that you need to destroy in order to liberate that outpost, whether it be satellite dishes or speakers or billboards, propaganda billboards or whatever. Yeah. Basically, you have to find everything that is the tyrant's, all of the tyrant's property in the outpost, and destroy it. And that's how you liberate it. But that's one of my criticisms, is that it's not very clear what you have to destroy.
So you just blow everything up.
You just blow everything up, hoping like hell it's what you're looking for. Because you can look for it on the map, but sometimes the map isn't a very clear indicator as to what or where the object is.
Yeah.
So it becomes kind of like a wild goose chase is running in a circle, like, okay, is that what I have to blow up? Okay, that's not it. So yeah, that's one of my criticisms, is that so far it's very repetitive, and also the whole chaos object mechanics are kind of confusing and not very well executed. But I do enjoy the game overall. It's a fun open world game where I blow shit up, and hey, I'm all for that. Bones, your next game? Bones, you have one game left.
I have one game left.
And you haven't played it.
Deus Ex, Mankind Divided.
Came out about a month ago.
Day one edition.
Comes with some DLC.
Apparently you can't kill progress. That's what the back says. I literally have not played this game yet.
She hasn't gotten to it yet.
I did play Human Revolution back fucking...
It's like 2012 or something.
4 years ago, maybe five.
It came out in 2011.
Yeah, so. I know, but I got it when it came out.
Mm.
So, it'll have been like 4 or 5 years
four
ago
now. 4 or 5 years.
I really enjoyed it. It was really, really fun. You had the option of going in stealth or guns blazing. I went in guns blazing because that's the only way I know how to play games.
But it's like it's like a first person, third person hybrid, right?
No.
Well, it's third person. Well, from what it's third person?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Every gameplay clip I saw of it was first person, except for when you go into cover and then it becomes third person.
Maybe. I don't know. You haven't played it in like four years. I swear. Maybe. I don't know. I can't remember.
Well, when you jump into Mankind Divided, you will know that I was right.
No, I'm pretty sure Human Revolution was third person.
I'm pretty positive.
I don't know. Don't quote me on that. This is two things you can't quote
Human
me
Revolution
on.
Was third person. Bones 2016.
So yeah, it was fun. You could play stealth, or you could play Rambo, or you could play both. You could go stealthy and Rambo-y.
In different areas.
It's kind of like Dishonored in that way.
Oh, okay.
Which I also played around the same time, so.
Yeah, roughly.
I haven't played this game yet.
Yeah.
I am planning on playing it.
At some point.
Obviously, because I bought it.
You bought it for new game price, so don't want to waste that $90.
You know what, though? Fucking Quantum Break. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Yeah.
Which
you still have to play.
Shut up. I'm really excited for this game because Human Revolution was so good, and it was one of my favorite games I
played. Of that year?
Yeah. It was one of my favorite games I played that year.
And this is one of your most anticipated of this year.
This is probably my most anticipated of this year. Other than Pokemon. But
Pokemon.
It's just Pokemon, man.
Pokemon.
Also Skyrim Remastered.
All right, that's coming out.
That's coming out.
That's coming out like next month.
I fucking want that.
No mods on PS4. Fuck you, Sony.
I don't have a PS4. I don't care. So yeah, I got the day one edition. It includes some stuff.
Some deals. Some
like it came with extra in-game missions.
Some dealcles.
A covert agent pack and some other shit.
Some books.
Some books?
Some books.
Oh, yeah, digital books.
Digital books?
Shit.
That you can read?
I don't know how far after Human Revolution this takes place.
Well, let's look at...
It says 2029. But I don't know when Human Revolution took place.
You know what? How about this? You talk about what you expect of this game, and I will look up when Human Revolution is
PC
set.
Gamer expects this to be the best Deus Ex yet, and I have to agree with them.
Shut up.
No, I've heard nothing but good things about this game. I've wanted to play it since it got announced. I didn't buy it at launch, but whatever.
Human Revolution was set in 2027, so that's 2 years after.
Oh, that's not bad. That's not a very big break.
No, not really.
Shit.
All I know is that Adam Jensen's sunglasses got even more sunglassy.
Yeah, he looks fucking awesome. So, and he looked awesome before.
Yeah, but that's another thing you have to talk about, Deus Ex. It's very character and story driven.
It is. I got really invested in Human Revolution because Adam Jensen was such a great character, and there was a lot of stuff that went on in the world. There was a lot of character building. It was very story driven.
There wasn't a lot of
variety in where you were or what you were doing.
Yeah, it was all just techno future city.
Yeah, but it was a very, very good story. And the combat, the gameplay was pretty complex. I got my ass kicked a lot. I actually ended up having to look up a guide at some point because I kept getting my ass kicked because I was trying to go stealth. Because you couldn't go, there was like one part you couldn't go Rambo, you had to go stealth, and I kept fucking it up because I'm not stealthy.
And then the story.
Reason number 275, I'm never playing Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, but the game also, in terms of the narrative, it has a lot of morality issues.
Yeah, I really liked that they went with the whole augmentation cyborg type thing. Because there's a lot of legal and ethical issues behind that right now.
How far can humanity go until you're not human anymore?
Given that this is in the future, it's a little bit less ethically questionable, probably, than it would be today if you were doing that.
Which is weird, because these games aren't set that far in the future.
No, it's not that far in the
future. It's only like 12, 13 years or so.
But I'm just like, It's an interesting way to bring up some of like the ethical and moral issues that surround like human augmentation.
What makes a human human?
Yeah, exactly. What makes a human human? How many robot parts do you need before you're not human anymore? Or like,
I would say how augmented, 75%.
How augmented are you before you're not really human anymore?
Yeah.
Like, that kind of thing. And, like, these games do a really good job of raising those kind of issues, like, kind of more in the background.
How many...
They take, like, a backseat to the actual story, but you're thinking about it. Or at least I am.
How many robo-metal parts do you stick in your butt until you're not human anymore? Is it 7? I don't know.
But yeah, I mean, like, it's in the back of your mind. Well, at least it's in the back of my mind when I'm playing Deus Ex.
Mm-hmm.
Especially Human Revolution, given that I never played a Deus Ex game before. I was just like, wow.
Yeah, yeah.
This kind of raises some, like, ethical or, like, some issues.
Which I don't know if Human Revolution was considered a reboot. Because I think it was the first Deus Ex game in a while.
It was the first Deus Ex game since Deus Ex.
I don't think that's true, though.
I think it is.
I think there was a sequel
in
between.
Don't quote me on that. No, I'm pretty sure.
There was only one game, Bones 2016.
I'm pretty sure that Human Revolution was the first Deus Ex game since Deus Ex.
Well, let's. You keep talking. I'll
not
look it up.
Including anything that came out for, like, mobile. Or maybe that was after Human
Deus
Revolution.
Deus Ex Go is a thing.
It was. Yeah. After Human Revolution.
Yeah.
I believe, yeah.
After Human Revolution.
But I'm pretty sure that Human Revolution was the first game in the Deus Ex series after Deus Ex, the original.
Well, let's see. We have Deus Ex 2000.
Oh, never mind.
Deus Ex Invisible War 2003.
Never mind.
And then Human Revolution 2011.
Yeah, but Human Revolution was an actual sequel. Those weren't actual sequels. Don't quote me on that. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Invisible War wasn't a sequel, Bones 2016. And then there was apparently also Deus Ex The Fall? Which
yes,
was a mobile
that
game.
That was the mobile game.
It was a mobile game.
Yes. There was also some expansion for Human Revolution, which I bought and never played.
Yeah, you never played it.
I should play it.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, I'm excited to play it. I have very high hopes for this game. I haven't heard anything bad about it other than it's a little bit short.
I've heard like overwhelmingly positive things about
it. I've heard
this
really good
game.
Things about it, other than it's a little bit shorter than Human Revolution was.
But even then,
I think it's like 4 or 5 hours shorter.
But even then, it's still like 10 plus hours.
Yeah. And the fact that I guess the ending is a little open-ended.
Which means they're going to do another game.
Sequel.
Sequel or
That's
DLC.
All I fucking have to say to you. Sequel.
Because there's already...
Or expansion. Like, they kind of did like Witcher. Witcher had 2 huge expansions. Witcher 3.
Because, like...
They might do expansions.
Well, the first story DLC comes out next week or so.
Yeah.
I think.
I would not have a problem spending, like, fucking $40 for a huge expansion. I would not. I would not have a problem with that.
Of course you would.
How much money did I spend on Witcher fucking expansions that I have?
Well, you bought the game new, so that was $90. And then you bought the season pass, which was $30.
No, I think it was $40.
$40?
Because the fucking expansions were like $30 a piece.
So that's $150.
Yeah. I haven't played the fucking expansions, but whatever. I would not be upset if they did an expansion type thing. Instead of an actual, like, next game.
Like a sequel, yeah.
Yeah, or, like, just to, like, continue the story a little bit between this one and the next one. I'm excited to play it.
All right.
10 out of 10 would recommend.
God damn it. Okay. I probably should have started because I still have two more games.
I told you.
But anyway, moving on, I got my next game here. Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain. Oh, boy. Here we go. Well, first off, I think I should talk a little bit about Ground Zeroes, because they did the whole two different game thing with this.
But it wasn't really a whole game.
Okay, let's talk about Ground Zeroes. So, I bought this because I heard nothing but great things about it, and it was on sale. But I hadn't played Ground Zeroes. I have a copy.
Which we got for free.
Yeah, I have a copy of Ground Zeroes. It was free for Games with Gold, I think last year at some point. But I never got around to playing it. So I played Ground Zeroes yesterday, and 2 hours later, I was done.
Yes.
Yeah. And that was one of the main criticisms of Ground Zeroes when it came out, was that the main storyline was only a couple of hours.
And they were charging, what, $30 or $40?
I think it was $40 when it came out. So unless you didn't know that after you beat the main story, there were side missions and stuff that open up that extend the game time, you would have spent $40 on a two-hour game.
Yeah, but still, I would still be upset about that because the side missions don't do anything for your story.
No.
Your story leading into Phantom Pain is the
is that one mission.
Is the hour and a half or 2 hours that you spend getting
Chico and Paws
out of the detainment camp, getting into a helicopter,
and then blowing
spoiler alert, exploding.
Yeah, and then blowing up.
So yeah, I would be pretty pissed if I had spent $30 or $40 for literally, like, what amounts to an hour and a half or 2 hours of story.
Yeah, but seeing as how...
like, maybe, like, half an hour of actual gameplay.
But seeing as how we got it for free...
I can't complain about that.
And there is incentive to go back. I'm not too upset, but I would feel sorry for anyone who spent full game price for that.
Yeah, if you spent $40, you got fucking screwed by Capcom. I mean... Konami.
God damn
Same fucking company.
Yeah, basically. Well, at least Capcom is trying to make things better.
True. I mean,
Resident Evil 7.
I know, I'm so excited.
Anyway. So, yeah. So, I played Ground Zeroes. 2 hours later, I was done. And then I booted up Phantom Pain. And 2 hours later, I was into the game.
Which also fucking lied to us, saying it was up to 10 fucking gigs.
Yeah.
Where it was, like, fucking, like, 30 or something.
Yeah, on the back, it's like, game disc requires up to 10 gig storage. And then I pop it in, and it's, like, 30 gig install. And I'm like,
what the
fuck? Well, fuck you, Metal Gear.
Fuck you, Konami, Capcom.
So, yeah, I started this game off. And even before the fucking title screen, there's like a 10-minute cinematic of Snake just looking around like, oh, I've been in a coma.
Okay, yeah, so at the end of Ground Zeroes, you explode in a fiery helicopter accident because Paz has an additional bomb in her.
Yeah, so, like, they go to Mother Base. Mother Base is destroyed by some other faction. I don't know
was
exactly.
Was it Cypher or?
I think it was Cypher. Yeah, I think it was Cypher. Destroyed Mother Base.
Don't quote me on that.
And then Snake and Kaz get out in a helicopter, and they notice that Paz has, like, a scar on her stomach, and they realize, oh shit,
she's got a
bomb. Implanted a bomb in her, so they literally tear this little girl open and, like, shove their hand right in her gut hole to pull out this bomb.
Yep.
And then she wakes up after they escape from Mother Base, and she's like, there's another bomb.
Yeah, and then she jumps out of the helicopter and explodes on the way down. Snake yells no, but gets
burned.
Exploded anyway.
Yeah.
So the whole premise of fucking Phantom Pain is that you wake up 9 years after that explosion.
You wake up from a coma.
In a hospital. You lost your arm. And you're also slightly crazy.
Yeah, you're also slightly crazy.
And brain damage. Because yeah. Because you also have, like, a thing of shrapnel.
You have shrapnel sticking in your head.
So you're, like, half demon because you have a horn.
You have, like, one horn.
You have one horn.
Tiny horn. But yeah, so you even before the fucking title screen, it's like 10 minutes of cinematic Snake waking up from his coma.
Yeah.
And then one thing that was weird at the beginning of the game is the doctor is like, you know, everyone's out to kill you. So I'm going to change who you are. I'm going to change your look.
You can alter Snake's appearance, which I didn't.
Yeah, I altered his appearance to make my own character, but then he only kept the facial features.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you could change, like, your beardiness and everything like that, but, like, they only
I think that actual full character will be Metal Gear Online avatar.
Yeah, probably.
Because there's an online
mode. But they keep Snake's, like, hair and his beardiness and whatever.
Yeah.
But you don't look like Snake anymore if you decided to customize your character.
So, yeah. So, the two-hour prologue is you escaping from the hospital where you get attacked by the man on fire. Who
is...
A guy.
Okay, see, we never played any of the Metal Gear games.
The only one I played was 3, and it was, like, for 2 hours.
So, coming into Phantom Pain, it was like, well, who's that? What's going on? Who is Cypher? Which Snake am I? What the fuck is happening? So, after some extensive Googling...
After some research.
We have figured out the Venom Snake is not the same as Big Boss.
No.
But technically, you are Big Boss.
Yeah.
Okay, so Naked Snake becomes Big Boss in Metal Gear 3. Solid 3.
Yeah.
And then Venom Snake is fucking somebody else from...
I don't fucking know.
I don't know, man. It's so confusing. Venom Snake is somebody else. But technically, Venom Snake is also Big Boss.
Yeah.
But, like, I think there's two fucking different timelines. Because Naked Snake and Venom Snake are not the same person, but they both are Big Boss at the, like...
Anyway.
It's so
fucking
confusing.
Back to the game.
And then the man on fire is somebody's reanimated corpse.
Yeah.
And I think it's General Vogan.
But then who's the fucking chick? Who's the chick with the gas mask and the red hair? And she's like,
okay.
She looks like Psycho Mantis, motherfucker.
I don't know, man. I don't know.
And she's fucking... like telekinetic and she can spawn fire whales and
shit. I don't know, man.
I don't know what's happening.
The man on fire is somebody's reanimated corpse who Naked Snake, Big Boss, killed in Metal Gear Solid 3, I believe. And then his corpse gets reanimated by Cypher.
And he's the man on fire.
He's part of Cypher, and he is the man on fire. But you are Venom Snake.
Yeah.
Which is not the same
Punished
as Naked Snake.
Venom Snake.
Yeah. So Naked Snake and Venom Snake are the same snake, but not the same
There's
snake.
There's like 6 different snakes, dude.
Because they become Big Boss, but they are also not the same person.
Anyway.
It's so confusing. What the fuck?
So anyway, in the span of the 2-hour prologue, I met a dude... Who I still don't know who he is. I think he was me, like an illusion of me.
I think he was in your mind.
Like you.
It was
like,
all in your head.
Okay, so Cypher attacks the hospital because they're trying to kill Snake.
Yes.
And then this dude that was in my hospital room, but the doctor never referenced or interacted with, jumps the assassin, and he's like got full face bandage, so you don't know who he is, but he sounds just like Snake.
Yes. Who is Kiefer Sutherland, by the way?
Yeah.
So like he's got a very distinctive voice.
Yeah. So. He shows up, he saves me, he gets me out of the hospital, and then the man on fire shows up and fucks everything up.
Yeah, and basically on your way out of the hospital, not Snake, in the bandages.
Dies. He gets shot with helicopter.
Also teaches you how to be Snake.
Yeah.
It's like you, releasing you into the wild.
It's like you wake up after 9 years and you're malnourished and you don't know what's going on.
Well, I don't
and
think
you've
you're
lost
necessarily malnourished, but you've lost a lot of weight because
you've lost
been,
a lot of muscle mass.
You've been sitting in bed for 9 years.
Yeah.
You're also heavily brain damaged because you've got
you got
bunch
shrapnel,
of shrapnel
in your fucking
in
head.
Your head and also near your heart and in some of your limbs.
Yes.
You've lost your
an arm. You got
not
a robot
your,
arm.
Not your whole arm, but you've lost part of your arm. And basically, you've been in a coma for 9 years, so you're severely weakened.
Yeah.
So what happens is that Not Snake teaches you how to be Snake and then dies, but
you never find his body.
You never find his... You turn around and he's gone.
He's gone. He's just straight
so
gone.
So I think that he wasn't actually there to begin
with. Yeah, I think, seeing as how he had the mentality of Snake. He sounded just like Snake. He's and like the fact that he disappeared after everything happened, I feel
I think he's like a projection from your brain damaged mind.
I feel like you were hallucinating an embodiment of your former self who taught you how to be who you once were.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I think happened. Yeah.
And then Ocelot shows up.
And then Ocelot shows up and
Who is Troy Baker?
Troy Baker. Troy Baker shows up on his white
horse. It's not a game without Troy Baker.
Troy Baker shows up on his mighty steed and he's like, we gotta go save Kaz. He's been kidnapped by Afghanis.
Yeah, who got blown up with you in Ground Zero.
But he survived.
On the helicopter.
And he wasn't in coma.
He wasn't in a coma and he got captured by Afghani soldiers.
And he also doesn't have an arm.
Or a leg. He lost his leg as well.
So after the 2-hour prologue, you escape the hospital, you go with Ocelot, and then you're in Afghanistan after like a week and a half of traveling. And
you get to ride a horse.
You've bulked up quite a bit in those 10 or so days.
Yeah, what the fuckle?
Yeah, right? I was like, you were so weak and skinny. How did you put on that much weight in that
such a little time? That one is like a little bit unbelievable because like if you've been in a coma and you've literally just been fed through an IV tube, like eating real food is just going to make you sick.
Yeah.
So like I don't understand how Snake bulked up, but maybe it's a different Snake. You never know.
Then again, there's a guy on fire.
True.
And a crazy psychic bitch. True. So
that is not.
Gotta suspend my disbelief with this one.
I know.
So yeah, so, and then the game actually starts, and you're in Afghanistan, and the game is open world. So was Ground Zeroes, but the world was much, much smaller. In this game, you have an open world Afghanistan to explore, and there's side missions to do, side ops, and there's enemy factions to interact with.
Intel to collect.
And, outposts to liberate, all
and
that
they
jazz.
And they tell you, okay, so like you've got, like, main missions, and then you've got side missions. Mm-hmm. And, like, the beginning, Ocelot's standing on a ridge with you, and he's just like, yeah, you're gonna have to go to that village and get some intel. And then you're probably gonna need to explore some other villages and get some other intel.
Nope!
And then you can go get Kaz.
No!
Well, fucking shit, you can just go right there and get Kaz, because the most suspicious building is the one that he's in.
Yeah, I went straight to the village that Ocelot told me to gather intel in. Killed everyone there, gathered no intel. Okay, whatever. And then I went to the village that Kaz was imprisoned in, and they're like, oh, you gotta gather some intel, find out where he's being held. Motherfucking village has a tower in the fucking back of it, and I'm like, that's where they're keeping him. That's where they're fucking keeping him. And I run right in, and the second room, he's right there, chained to a fucking radiator.
Yep.
Like, fuck, man. Anyway. So yeah, the game's open world. Presentation is fantastic.
Well, yeah, it looks awesome.
This
obviously, the story.
All of these games look fucking great, this one
that
in
one
particular.
Looks particularly good.
I specifically like the cinematic value to it. Like, the cinematography is great. It's all, like, handheld camera angles and shit.
And it was kind of the same thing in Ground Zeroes.
Yeah.
Ground Zeroes was literally, like, an extended movie trailer.
Yeah. Yeah, I like the cinematography with the whole handheld camera kind of thing. It adds a lot of cinematic flair to the game.
Well, that's Kojima for you.
Yeah, that's Kojima. Praise Kojima.
The thing that we noticed is that if you buy this, Kojima's logo is nowhere on the box.
Nope.
And neither does it say that he directed it or produced it.
His name is not anywhere on that box.
Nope. Nowhere.
So fuck you, Konami.
Yeah, fucking Konami.
Suck my fucking nads.
Yeah.
Anyway, the game itself. So the gameplay, it's very similar to Ground Zeroes. It's the same engine, same control scheme. They changed a few things to make it more fluid. Like a few things that I was confused about in Ground Zeroes, they blatantly fixed it and told you, hey, this is how you do this, which was nice. I like the open world aspect of it because a lot of Metal Gear games aren't exactly open world. A lot of them are very linear. So I like that aspect of it. It makes it a little fresh and different from the other ones. Snake is awesome.
This is also canonically before Metal Gear Solid 1.
Yes.
But after number 3.
Yes.
And Peace Walker.
The timeline's confusing as fuck.
It is. So it goes like Metal Gear Solid 3. Ground and then Zeroes. I believe the one
Walker.
I believe the one that was on PSP.
Or Portable Ops.
Yeah.
And then Peace Walker.
And then Ground Zeroes. And then this. This is 9 years after Ground Zeroes.
And then Metal Gear.
Yes.
And then Metal Gear 2.
Yes.
And then Metal Gear Solid.
Yes.
And then 2 and then 4.
So.
And then technically Rising, because Rising's set after 4.
Honestly, this is so confusing. This is actually, I believe, more confusing than the Zelda timeline.
Yeah, it is.
Because at least Zelda is, like, pretty much the same game each time.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, overall, my final thoughts on Phantom Pain.
10 out of 10 would recommend if you like fucking confusing shit.
Okay. Presentation is outstanding. The gameplay is fun. It's very fluid. I like the open world aspect of it. There's a lot of variety in the gameplay. There's a lot of different ways you can go about your missions. You can be stealthy, or at least try to be.
Yeah, you or you can go at stealth.
Yeah,
you suck at
stealth. I suck at stealth, and yet I bought a Metal Gear game. But whatever. Yeah, overall, this is a great game so far. I do not recommend it to newbies of Metal Gear. This is definitely not, like, baby's first Metal Gear.
I don't think there is a baby's first Metal Gear.
Start with Metal Gear 3, because that's technically first in the timeline.
Yes, but I don't think it's baby's first Metal Gear. I don't think any of the Metal Gear games or Metal Gear Solid games are baby's first Metal Gear.
Well, I have to say, I highly recommend this to Metal Gear fans or fans of action stealth games. However, if you never played a Metal Gear game,
you will start be confused.
Start with 3, skip this one for now, and come back to it later.
Yeah, you will, like, I'm honestly regretting not doing that first. Because I am so fucking confused.
I have no clue the fuck's going on.
Yep.
So anyway, my final game here is Mirror's Edge Catalyst. The sequel to Mirror's Edge came out back in 2008.
Which is technically a prequel.
It's technically a prequel, yes.
That was the other thing. Zero Time Dilemma is technically a prequel to Virtue's Last Reward.
God damn it.
Did you know that?
So it takes place between 999 and...
Yep. But technically after as well. It's a sequel and a prequel.
So the pre-sequel.
No, seriously, it's a prequel and a sequel because technically Sigma existed before this game, and I used this in this game, but then everybody else, all this stuff happened before that game.
So it's Borderlands.
Yeah.
Pre-sequel. Anyway.
Anyway.
So, here we go. Mirror's Edge Catalyst. I was very hyped for this game. This is one of my most anticipated games of the year. And after a couple delays, it finally came out, and I just recently picked it up because it's now $40.
True.
It's not on sale. It's literally just $40.
Yep.
When this came out, though, I heard a lot of the reviewers say that this game was pretty meh. Even though I didn't really watch or read any of the reviews to find out why, a lot of people said this game was okay, but nothing great. But then I played it, and I was like, what the fuck you talking about, bro?
I think it was because it was so hyped, because Mirror's Edge was so good.
It was.
It's just, like, it's not really any different. Other than it's more open world. But, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, something that's just so hyped, and then it's like, oh, well.
Yeah, I'm
disappointed now.
I understand why that would be a bad thing for some people. I totally get that, because, like... This game came out 8 years after the original.
Yeah.
So if you were waiting that long for a sequel, only to find out that it's basically the same game with prettier graphics and a couple different things,
yeah,
I would be disappointed too. But then again, when I was thinking about a Mirror's Edge sequel, all I wanted was more of Mirror's Edge.
You could have just played Mirror's Edge. See, when I'm looking for a sequel...
Fuck you, man.
No, but like when I'm looking for a sequel, I'm looking for something a little bit different.
See, that's me, but for certain games I'm like that, but for other games I'm not. Case in point, this game, when I wanted a sequel to Mirror's Edge, I just wanted more of what made Mirror's Edge great, which was free running, parkour, all that jazz. And that's what I got. Well, first off, it's open world, which the first game was not. The first game was very linear. So you have an open world city to explore and parkour around. And it takes skill to navigate the city properly, because if you don't know where you're going, you'll just fly off a building and
That's why I'm not playing this game, because I was bad at the first Mirror's Edge.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to be good at this one.
So yeah, it's open world. Obviously, with an open world structure, you have main and side missions.
Yes.
And also different challenges you can do. There's a lot of stuff to do in the world.
There's a lot of collectibles.
Yeah, there's tons of collectibles. You have XP, which was in the first one. There was XP in the first one, which you can use to upgrade your different attributes and gain more skills and gear and all that stuff. yeah, there's a lot of stuff to do in this game. In the first, I'm like 2 or 3 hours into this game, and I mainly focus on side missions. There were like at least 2 or 3 side quest trees that opened up, and there were a lot of challenges and races that I could do on the side. And there's a lot of things you can interact with in the world. Like there's billboards that you can, like digital billboards that you can hack, and you can show your player emblem. And then your friends can also find your billboards in their game and then hack to show their emblem.
Oh, yeah.
Because I went up to a billboard. Do what? My nose is itchy. I'm also sick. I'm sick. Anyway. So, I found that out because I went up to a billboard and it said that this billboard... I went up to the billboard and discovered that this billboard was Nick's. So then I hacked it to make it mine. And I'm sure if Nick boots up the game and he goes back to that same billboard, he'd be like, the fuck, bro?
No, he won't.
That was my billboard.
He won't even care.
So yeah, there's a lot of stuff you can interact with. The graphics are fantastic, like a lot of the games we talked about today.
Yeah, it looked really, you know, crisp.
Presentation nice. Is outstanding.
It's very colorful.
Yes.
Whereas the first game, honestly, was a little bit muted.
Yeah, it had a muddy contrast to it.
Yeah, and it had, like, one color scheme, whereas this, like, game is pretty fucking colorful.
Yeah, there was, like, it was predominantly white and red. And then when you go to different areas, it was maybe, oh, this area is green or this area is orange or whatever. Yeah, there's a lot more visual variety in this game, which is a nice change of pace. The characters are hit and miss.
See,
some of them are cool, some of them aren't.
See, what I found weird about this game is that, okay, you're going to make a game 8 years later.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to have all these upgraded graphics and all this new shit for you to do and ways for you to... It's a fucking prequel.
Yeah. Game developers do that all the time.
It just didn't make any sense to me. I was just like, why would you do a prequel when you could do a sequel? Yeah, I understand that, but like that's different because that's a whole fucking alternate timeline bullshit. That is just, I don't know, I would have personally done a sequel. I would have been like, yeah, fuck yeah, let's fucking follow Faith as she, you know, explores after, you know, she saves her sister and whatever.
Yeah.
But they fucking did a prequel. It's fucking weird.
Yeah, but game developers do that all the time.
I don't know, it's
They're like,
weird.
This game is set before the first, but there's more to it than the first.
Yeah, but it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, I know it doesn't make sense.
Because
but
I'm just like, if you're going to do all of that shit, just make it a sequel because it makes more sense chronologically. Like, these games, the fucking Metal Gear games... They're all very similar in gameplay and whatever. Like, they're all whatever.
Pretty similar.
This is adding, like, a whole bunch of shit that wasn't in the first game. You're making it more open world. You're making it open world, whereas the first game was not open world at all. You're adding collectibles and side missions and races and shit like that. I mean, like, it makes more sense for a sequel than a prequel. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I get
know.
It, but...
I don't know, it just
They do that all the time.
Just, like, don't... Yeah, but after there's been a sequel.
They still do it pretty frequently.
It doesn't fully make sense.
But anyway, the game. What was I talking about? The characters. Some of them are cool, some of them, eh. I'm kind of actually divided on Faith right now.
I don't like her.
I'm like, I want to like you, but there's something about you that I just don't like in this game.
She seems whiny.
She seems whiny. She seems like the social outcast, which she wasn't in the first game.
No, she was like fucking friends with everybody.
But then again, seeing as how this is a prequel, it makes sense because it's kind of an origin story. But at the same time, you're degrading her character by doing that.
Yeah. That's the other thing is that like...
I get it's a coming of age thing,
yeah,
but still.
If you're going to do like fucking reversing, like doing a fucking 180 on your character, like... Make it so that, like, she actually... Like, how long is this game?
No idea.
Oh. Because I was going to say, if she doesn't at least develop through the course of the game...
I'm sure she'll develop. Like, because seeing as how it is a prequel and it's kind of, like, the story of how she came to be in the first game, I assume there's going to be some character development here where, like, she starts off, like, whiny and kind of a prick and... not very sociable.
Yeah.
And then by the end, something will happen where she, like, does a 180 and then becomes the character she eventually will be. But...
I don't know, man.
You know, seeing as how this game came after the first one, I did like Faith in the first one. Yeah, now I don't like her.
Cool. I'm not really a fan
now,
of her.
Now
she,
I don't like her.
She seems pretty whiny. Also, the fact that the game starts out, you just got out of prison.
Yeah.
Why were you in prison?
Well, I'm sure they'll explain it eventually. Like, the whole story is that Faith gets out.
I want that game, man.
The whole story is that Faith gets out of prison after 2 years, and then she reconnects with the runners, Noah and all those people. She reconnects with the runners to get back out into the street, and she needs to get script to pay back this person called Dogen, who's apparently, like, this super scary dude who's like, hey, yo, I did you a favor. You need to pay me back, bitch.
See, another reason why this would have worked more as a sequel than a prequel. Maybe she gets arrested after she saves her sister because of all the fucking shit that she did in the first game.
So, yeah.
Sequel.
Sequel. Reboot. Yeah. Anyway.
I don't know, man.
So, yeah, that's the story. She needs to, like, get script to pay back this guy who I don't know who he is yet. They'll explain it, but I don't know who he is yet.
Why was she in prison for 2 years?
Yeah, I want to know that.
Can we get a game with her in prison?
Orange is the New Faith?
Or Orange is the New Faith.
So yeah, in terms of the gameplay and the presentation, I'm really liking the game so far. In terms of the story, though, it hasn't won me over yet.
That's what I mean. Like, it should have been a sequel, not a prequel.
Yeah.
It just, like, you get, like, all invested in Faith and everything in the first one. She's saving her sister and shit. And then it's like, yeah, our second game's gonna be a prequel. And we're completely changing our character. And, Yeah, there's not really a concrete story here.
Well, it makes sense why her character would be different, but...
Not that much different. I don't know, man. It just seems weird to me.
So, yeah.
I'm not gonna get over it.
So, yeah, that's all my games. I'm done.
That's all my games too. I'm done.
All right. So
see ya.
What do you got? What do we talk about?
Things.
I had Dark Souls.
Yeah, I had stuff. I had all these games.
Look at these games. Look at them. They're going everywhere. That game's surprisingly heavy.
Anyway, so
Games. Unless you have anything else you want to talk about, I guess we'll wrap things up here.
I want to talk about how much I hate Uncharted 4. I haven't said it since July. I hate Uncharted 4.
You know what?
Fight me.
You know what? I am starting an online petition to boycott Uncharted 4. If you want to sign this petition and support the cause, there will be a link in the description. Spread the word. We hate Uncharted 4.
It's been like 3 or 4 months since I said that to a camera or a microphone.
But anyway.
I hate Uncharted 4.
So anyway.
Fuck you, Nathan Drake. If that is your real name.
If that is your real name.
I don't think it is.
No, I don't think it is either. But anyway, I think we're done here. I've talked about all my games. You've talked about all your games. So with that said, we're going to wrap things up here. So thank you very much for watching this episode of the Bearded Banter Podcast. If you like what you've seen, you can subscribe to the BGNs on YouTube for more exciting gaming content, including Let's Plays, podcasts, reviews, unboxings, live streams, etc.
And Uncharted 4 hate.
Yeah, and Uncharted 4 hate campaign coming soon.
To a theater near you.
So,
we're going to get kicked out.
Yeah, so thanks for watching. If you like what you've seen here, you'll be happy to know we do an episode of the podcast every single Wednesday.
I don't think anybody's happy.
Every single Wednesday.
I'm not happy.
Every fucking Wednesday. So we'll see you guys next week for another exciting podcast. I'm your host, The Bearded One. Joining me is Bones.
I hate Uncharted 4.
And we'll hate Uncharted 4 next week.
Look at all these games.
See you later. Keep on gaming. Okay, get out of my house.
Oh.